This video is brought to you by Surfshark. CO2 is infamous for being the major culprit of climate change. But what if this global warming villain could turn into a green energy hero? Believe it or not, carbon dioxide may be a key component in developing a new green battery that can be quickly deployed around the world. Now, if you think I'm just gasbagging you, you'll definitely want to check this out. Could giant glass bladders of CO2 solve our energy storage problem? Let's see if we can come to a decision on this. As you might know, carbon dioxide is one of the main greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. And to be more specific, CO2 accounts for around 3/4 of global man-made emissions. CO2 and other greenhouse gases are naturally present in our atmosphere and act as a sort of blanket for the planet. It's essential that we have this blanket, but our blanket is getting metaphorically thicker and holding onto too much heat. Now, clearly CO2 is the bad guy in this scenario, but there might be room for a redemption story here. Now, renewable energy is one of the top weapons we have to fight global warming by reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Yet its intermittency reduces the climate mitigation potential, which is why we desperately need cost-efficient and long-lasting storage systems to manage its ups and downs. Well, carbon dioxide may give us what we're looking for. Last June, the Italian startup Energydome successfully demonstrated the operation of the world's first CO2 battery on a pilot scale in Sardinia. With plenty of sunshine and wind, the isolated area is triggering a sea of renewable opportunities. While the storage capacity of their proven device was only 4 megawatt hours, their first commercial scale plant will have 200 megawatt hours and is expected to go live by the end of next year. Now, after testing, the Energydome's battery seems to be ready to store renewable energy and dispatch it over 24 hours anywhere in the world. Besides the recent $11 million fundraising to commercialize their utility-scale long-duration batteries, the startup's already inked some deals. For instance, they're going to put together a 20-megawatt, 5-hour facility for A2A, the second largest Italian utility company. On top of that, Undecided Energia signed them up for developing energy storage systems in Italy, Germany, the Middle East, and Africa. Using CO2 against climate change sounds a bit controversial, or ironic. So how does that actually work? Energydome technology is based on a closed-loop thermodynamic system. During the charging process, the plant taps into the grid renewable energy surplus, and that drives a motor drawing CO2 from a massive dome-shaped double membrane gas holder, which is basically just a giant bladder. Now here the gas is stored at ambient temperature and pressure. Now, after being pressurized through a turbocompressor, CO2 turns into a highly dense liquid, which is stored in a sort of fire extinguisher at room temperature and 70 bar, which is about 1015 PSI. Essentially, the charging step stores renewable energy into high-pressure liquid CO2. At the same time, the system recovers and stores the compressed induced heat into two thermal units. When it's time to discharge the power, the recovered heat is then reused to convert the liquid CO2 back to vapor. After passing through an expander, the gaseous stream drives a turbine to generate electricity that will be delivered back to the grid. And to close the loop, the CO2 is sent back to the dome to start the next charging cycle. If you're worried about needing a lot of CO2 to keep topping up the system over time, don't worry. It's a closed loop system. I had a chance to talk to Claudio Spadaccini, the CEO of Energydome, and here's what he had to say about the system setup.
We charge the system with CO2 at the beginning of the life, just 1/30 years. So we don't use continuously CO2. It's like the refrigerator, let's say, in your car conditioner, that you have just to charge at the beginning, and the CO2 which we use is just the, let's say, the working fluid in our battery.
So at the end of the day, the system will only eat up a few hundred tons of CO2 to begin with, without requiring any more gas once it's up and running. This is just a few bubbles compared to what our fossil fuel plants are emitting every year. It's not so much the CO2 that's used by the system, but rather the CO2 that's not generated through fossil fuels for power generation that makes this a green system. But the fact that CO2 is involved at all does make it a little ironic. If this basic principle sounds familiar, it's probably because it is. CO2 under pressure is not the only gas that you can use as a storage medium. Leveraging a similar approach, you can harness pressurized air instead. Based on how you compress air, you can have either compressed air energy storage or liquid air energy storage. As for the second process, rather than using a compressor to reduce its volume, you cool it down to negative 196 degrees Celsius, which is why it's also called cryogenic energy storage. Now, I have another video on this exact topic if you're interested. So how does CO2 compare to air for storing energy? Before getting into that, I'd like to thank today's sponsor, Surfshark. I always recommend using VPNs when using public Wi-Fi, but VPNs can also be very useful when you're at home. A lot of online services use some pretty sophisticated commercial tracking and machine learning to apply very targeted advertising. A VPN can protect you from some of that. Now, Surfshark's clean web does a great job blocking ads, trackers, and malicious websites, making it safer to use the internet even at home. And you can even make it look like your IP address is coming from a completely different country. This can come in handy if you want to stream a video that's only available from a specific location. One of the best parts of Surfshark is that it's easy to set up on all your devices, whether that's iPhone or Android, Mac or PC. Surfshark is the only VPN to offer one account to use with an unlimited number of devices. Use my code to get 83% off plus 3 extra months for free. Surfshark offers a 30-day money-back guarantee, so there's no risk to try it out for yourself. The link is in the description below, and thanks to Surfshark and all of you for supporting the channel. Now back to how CO2 compares to air for energy storage. Let's look at energy density, for instance, which gives you an idea of how many kilowatt hours you can store per unit of volume. Now, according to figures reported by Energy Dome on their website, their CO2 battery energy density is up to 11 times higher than compressed air energy storage. Now, my team and I fact-checked this, and they're pretty much right. Even when considering the maximum value of compressed air energy density reported in literature, Energy Dome's is still 6 times greater. Now, for this reason, compressed air systems need humongous spaces like underground salt caverns to store the low energy density compressed air. And this can be found only in specific locations, which limits the scalability. On the other hand, liquid air can pack nearly 2 times more kilowatt hours per cubic meter compared to the Energy Dome system. Nevertheless, for liquid air to work, you need to get down to really low temperatures to liquefy the air. Plus, to generate electricity, you have to warm up the liquefied air back to room temperature. Now, this drastic cooling and warming cycle bites into the process round-trip efficiency, ranging from 45 to 70%. Unlike liquid air energy storage, the CO2 used in the Energy Dome system is stored at ambient temperatures, which reduces the operational costs and energy penalties. Also, Energy Dome's design is pretty simple as it employs only 2 steps, meaning compression and evaporation. Compared with lower operational temperatures, this leaner schematic minimizes energy losses, which leads to a round-trip efficiency of up to 75 to 80%. Aside from being more efficient than air at storing energy, CO2 may also be a solid alternative to metal-based batteries. As claimed by Energy Dome in their press release, their device would be more than 50% cheaper than a similar-sized lithium-ion battery. Now, apparently, once at full scale, they projected their 25-megawatt, 200-megawatt-hour plant to have a levelized cost of storage as low as $50 per megawatt-hour. At this point, we'll have to trust them on that figure, but according to Lazard, they estimated the levelized cost of storage of a 4-hour, 100-megawatt, 400-megawatt-hour lithium-ion battery storage system to range between $131 and $232 per megawatt-hour. And liquid air energy storage is not any cheaper, with a levelized cost of storage stretching up to $300 per megawatt-hour. I can hear some of you already. How about pumped hydro storage? Besides being the world's largest long-duration utility-scale power storage installations, they can last up to 150 years. Yet their levelized cost of storage is pegged at $186 per megawatt-hour, which is floating well above what Energy Dome is promising. Now, of course, we'll have to wait at least till the end of 2023 or 2024 to see whether Energy Dome will go over its predicted budget. Other than being one of the most wanted fugitives in the world, Energy Dome's key ingredient is much more sustainable than commercial batteries' raw materials. For example, extracting 1 ton of lithium drinks up 500,000 gallons of fresh water. Another major cathode component is nickel, which wins the shameful race for the most carbon-intensive mining. When it comes to cobalt, about 70% of the world's supply comes from the Democratic Republic of Congo, which has a horrible track record with forced labor, child labor, and safety. Energy Dome batteries only need steel, CO2, and water. So the CO2 battery can be built using off-the-shelf equipment taken from the existing supply chain. That makes the system easily scalable. For example, the compressor is the current standard used in the oil and gas industry. This could give Energy Dome a key advantage here.
I don't see any kind of challenge in the supply chain. The big advantage which we have is that this technology is based on an existing industry. Vessels, heat exchangers, compressor, turbine, generator, motor. This is an industry which is present everywhere. It's present in North America, it's present in Europe, and it's present in the Far East. So I don't see any kind of constraints like many other technology have. There are many other technology which have bottleneck in the supply chain.
Another limitation of lithium-ion batteries is time. From a storage point of view, most installations max out at around 6 hours for the best cost advantage. Now, obviously, that's not enough to back up the grid during extended periods of low renewable energy generation or overnight. That's where Energy Dome would come in handy, as their CO2 battery could churn out energy for up to 24 hours and beyond. Now, aside from short-term limitations, lithium-ion batteries' lifespan is 15 years at best, as their performance degrades with charging cycles. In contrast, Energy Dome's system is meant to last for up to 30 years without degradation. Now, flexibility is another plus of the Energy Dome solution. They're using a modular approach to customize their battery size and match different storage requirements. So it sounds like this Italian startup has killed 2 birds with 1 carbonated stone. creating a promising long-term energy storage option using the same gas that's causing some of our problems. As promising as it sounds, there are some challenges though. Unlike compressed air, which stores pressurized air underground, Energy Dome keeps CO2 at atmospheric pressure in an above-ground inflatable gas holder, or the dome. Just like a CO2-filled tennis court bubble, as their CEO Claudio put it, the potential issue is space. How well does the system scale size-wise? He did confirm the space is one of Energy Dome's limitations compared to lithium-ion batteries.
In terms of dimension, our system is not the most compact, and this is the only cons which we have versus lithium-ion batteries. We use about 7 to 8% of the land we need for the solar PV plant, which should produce the power that we can store.
As mentioned earlier, Energy Dome hopes to reach a round-trip efficiency of 75 to 80%. On that note, Claudio had this to say.
So now we had a lot of people which was not believing in us. It was too fast. So we are claiming 75% efficiency and there are still many people which doesn't believe. They say it's not possible. But now we promised something. Our idea is that we promise and we deliver. So we really want to prove what we say.
Energy Dome has been doing just that with the pilot plant. If we assume Energy Dome will hit the 75 to 80% target, that means they lose 20 to 25% of the energy that's put into the battery. In contrast, lithium-ion batteries get about a 90% round-trip efficiency, which means you're only losing 10% of the energy that you put in. Now, if you do the math, you'll see that the Italian startup is losing about 2.5 times more energy through the round-trip efficiency. However, this isn't something we should necessarily worry about. The largest pumped hydro energy storage systems in the world only achieve about 80% efficiency too. In other words, for short-form energy storage of up to 6 hours, batteries still have the edge. But when looking at long-duration energy storage, Energy Dome holds its own quite nicely. However, Claudio raised a point worth remembering. Lithium-ion batteries slowly degrade over time, so the amount they can store also degrades. Energy storage systems like Energy Dome and pumped hydro don't lose any storage potential over time. When looking at longer duration technologies, direct competitors worldwide are stepping on the gas and may soon catch up to the Italian rival. For instance, the UK-based Highview Power said that their 100 megawatt wind-powered liquid air energy storage could hit the $50 per megawatt hour target by 2030. Ecogen made the exact same claim across the pond, except they've developed a thermal storage recipe featuring sand, ice, and supercritical CO2. When it comes to Energy Dome, we're not going to have to wait too long to see how it performs. They not only spun up their pilot test quickly, but they're also being very aggressive with their upcoming projects. Some of that confidence comes from their simplified supply chain and parts used.
Since our product is a standardized product, and we will repeat, just by economy of scale, we will be able, in less than a couple of years, to cut that delivery time below 1 year, including construction.
While this sounds too fast to be true, it wouldn't be the first turbo speed scale-up for Energy Dome. Turning the evil CO2 into a climate savior sounds exciting, and Energy Dome does seem to know what they're doing. However, it's best to slow down the hype machine just a little bit until we see the real cost of their first commercial scale plant in a year or two. It may not be the silver bullet to the climate change dilemma, because there are no silver bullets here, but it may reduce the need for fossil fuels as a backup source of power for renewables, and it may reduce the mining required for metallic batteries. Regardless, CO2-based storage systems won't entirely replace lithium-ion batteries, which are still the most cost-efficient option for lower-scale short-run applications. So an integration of the two technologies may be the best green deal for the years ahead. So are you still undecided? Do you think that the CO2 battery will catch on for utility-scale energy storage? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones over here. And thanks to all my patrons for your continued support. And thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.